I was quite lucky. Sometimes you just you get a feel for something because you're right place, right time. And I was actually doing an interview with Gunther, and he'd obviously to come and do his media sessions.
I actually heard him say he doesn't believe American journalists can cover Formula One as well as European bred journalists. Sorry, couldn't resist.
To be fair to him, I remember him saying we spoke about this, and his point is that the age of the team means it can't take an American driver or a US-based driver, someone with no Formula One experience at this stage, and give them that experience because it doesn't have the infrastructure, the capacity, the luxury. It's not at the level it needs to be.
Sure, for sure. No, understood.
To let them learn their trade. What he says needs to happen for Haas to have an American driver is another team with the ability to do it, a bigger team perhaps, a team with a young driver program that's bigger. Because Haas does have Santino Ferrucci in a young driver program. It does have a young American in there. Is for them to give this experience, you know, a team with the capacity to let a driver learn the ropes and get the F1 experience. And then when it's an experienced American, that's the guy they take. Because you look at their lineup now, they've got Romain Grosjean and Kevin Magnussen because they both have experience in bigger F1 teams racing. You know, McLaren, Lotus, Renault, both of them have raced for and have been through. So that's what they need to move them forward. And to be fair to him, this year, I think we're going to see them move forward, and it's going to prove that strategy right. So, I think Gunther's very hardline. He just said stuff as it is, and if he thinks something can't happen, he won't tiptoe around the issue. He'll say we can't do it for this reason, and then sometimes it blows up in his face, and he has to sort of try and qualify his comments. But I think Haas are going to be moving forward. So I think he'll be able to move on from that pretty quickly because the car looks good. He went from this, yeah, we did this interview at testing, and then before, he wanted to run off and speak to someone before he did another interview, and he got stopped by Stuart Morrison, their head of comms or their PR guy that was at the circuit, and Stuart said, I'll just look at this, and pointed to something on the laptop, and Gunther's eyes lit up and a big grin, and he went, wow, and I was like, oh, something I'm not allowed to see, and Stuart went, oh, it's just the times. And then he just spun it around, and it was the lap times from the day, and it was what I believe Kevin Magnussen had just done. No, it must have been Grosjean. The lap time he'd done on the final day. And they were so buoyed by it. They're really confident for this year. So I think we're going to see Haas really mixing it with Renault and McLaren at the start of the year. And there's going to be a different Haas this year because last year they didn't develop their car, really. They focused, like you said, about writing off a year, tanking, basically, for the following year. Obviously, in F1, you don't tank in the sense there's not a lot to be gained,
yep,
in terms of a draft pick or something like that. But you do allocate your resources differently, take the short-term pain so that you have the opportunity to do better the following year. They did that, and they put so much effort into this car. It looks like with a lot of work alongside Ferrari that they've now got something that looks like it will really move them forwards. And I think there's going to be a Haas fighting with a Renault and a McLaren in that best of the rest scrap, certainly at the start of the season. But they've also promised to develop the car this year. They've got, as you say, more stable team. They're expanding still. They've got more capacity to develop a car during the year. And the regulations are going to be so stable that you're not going to be making massive gains next year if you focus on next year's car when it's the third year of the regulations. So you need to do it in season. So, yeah, they're going to change that approach. It'll be the first year that Haas have really developed the car during the year, and that's the test of how successful they'll be. If they develop it well, they can stay top six all season. If their lack of experience means they don't develop very well, then they might slip away as the year goes on. But I think they'll start in a really good position.
I look at their driver lineup, Chris, and of all the driver lineups, for teams that I think can have relatively successful years, this one might be the biggest mystery to me. We know that we've seen Romain do impressive things throughout the years, but he seems so easily steered into discontent. I look at Kevin, and I don't pretend that his father and I are best friends or even remotely close, but having covered Yan, you know, gotten to know him enough that he and I have a pretty easy relationship, I do see a lot of that steely determination of Yan's downloaded into Kevin, but with a more dickish demeanor to it. What comes to mind with these two? I can look at some other driver lineups, how's this, and see how they can, as a unit, elevate the team. I don't know if I would accuse the Grosjean and Magnussen duo of being that type of cohesive driver unit, but also I don't know if that matters in this day and age where, one a team can focus so heavily on its individual drivers and extract from them and then elevate the team, whether they mesh or are really, a good tandem in the true kind of, arms around one another's shoulders, we're team Haas, so we're going to beat the world type mentality. What do you think?
I think just the way the sport's changed, there's so much more done on simulation and things that the driver's kind of influence in terms of the direction of a car development and team development is lessened slightly. So you don't need them both sort of putting their heads together and driving it forward as a unit. You need them just pushing each other, and sometimes that means not getting on so well. So I don't see it hurting in that sense. I see Roman's kind of complaints. He doesn't deliver them very well, but they are him saying where the car is weak, and that is someone trying to push it forward. That's saying this is a big problem. We've got to fix it. He could do with finding a kind of smoother way of delivering that message sometimes, because it gets a bit tiresome hearing the same complaints over and over again, and with more and more exasperated delivery. But I think this year, they've made changes to the brakes. He wasn't complaining about them in testing, so I think we'll get less of that during the year. I think the problem for Roman is that I feel the ship has sailed for him to get a race-winning seat, a championship-winning car. I think that's gone really for him. So it's just whether his motivation level is the same, or if he lets that frustration get to him and annoy him that, his career is going to be defined by the results he's already got and how much Haas progresses while he's driving there. I think Kevin's the opposite, though. I think he kind of saw that this is his second chance, maybe even his third chance. The way McLaren went, and then he almost dropped out of the sport, came back at Renault, but then they wouldn't commit to him longer term. And he gets himself into Haas, and he just seems to fit that atmosphere. He likes it there. He likes the no-nonsense approach. And yeah, it just seems to get sort of a good performances out of him more often than maybe I expected. So with having one of them at least being nice and settled and more content, I think then their performances will push the other. So I don't think they're too bad a pairing, actually. I think for what Haas needs as well is just consistent points results if the car's good enough to do it. And this year's car looks like it'll be good enough to do it. So I back the two of them to be able to deliver those results. But I still think we've got to remember this is the third year for this team. And so, I mean, Sauber was comfortably off the back last year, but this year, he's got Alfa Romeo backing and should be a bit closer to the midfield. There are no more really off the back teams, tiny teams that are just running around and risking not even qualifying. So it's a very competitive sort of set of midfield teams that Haas is fighting in, and it needs to just, it can't afford to look too far ahead. It needs to deliver here and now. So it needs these sorts of drivers that have got enough experience and deliver the almost the boring results. The car's capable of sixth, so they get sixth and seventh. That sort of thing. It can't really worry itself with having a future world champion who will pull out a fourth or a third every now and then, but also will throw it in the wall more often than not. So yeah, the team always has to be boring in that sense, because it's still establishing itself and still growing. But as it does that, then it can start to attract even higher quality of drivers if it's moving forward, and it looks like it will move forward. So no, I'm quite when I said about Red Bull being a great story, whatever happens, I think the Haas driver lineup is one that, isn't much of a story, whatever happens this year. They're both out of contract at the end of this year, but you still, people aren't going, "Oh, what's going to happen there?" We'll see what happens as the year goes on. But no, I think it's just more the team's progression, and with the setup it's got, I think that's what interests people more than its kind of drivers. And the team knows that, so it's gone for some, basically two safe pairs of hands that are. And not a huge amount more than that, but unless they have, they have the odd day. We've seen Roman with some of his big finishes. Kevin showed it in the McLaren every now and then. You know, they do have it every now and then. They can pull out a big result, but you don't expect it that often from them, and I don't think that bothers Haas too much, to be honest.
My only concern for Kevin is, and I'm probably the millionth person to say this, I don't know, but it's not as if a Formula One driver will ever make it easy for another driver to pass. There's, you know, really no effort among competitive drivers to open the door, and just we expect a Kevin Magnussen to fight for every inch just constantly. I worry about how hard and how excessive those efforts last season, in particular, might have colored the opinion of his fellow competitors. And it comes back to the, yes, you know, it's the responsibility of the overtaking driver to complete a safe pass, but it also comes down to the driver that you're engaged in the fight with to say, okay, I'm not going to give this up. I'm never going to make this easy. And trust me, you're going to work harder for this than anything you've ever done. But I'm also willing to acknowledge the point where I'm beaten and allow you to go by and minimize my own time loss so I can hopefully get you back. Then there's the, you have proven to be such an a-hole driver who is attempting to pass me and shown just a complete, you know, a wanton disregard for myself and my race beyond what we would accept as the Grand Prix norm, that I'm going to now go out of my way to inconvenience you, to slow you down, to not just to make things hard, but if you want to take things to such drastic measures, hit me, you know, potentially wreck my race just to get by, dear Kev, well, maybe that's how I need to start treating you. And if enough drivers take that, oh, that guy's coming, well, I got one for you, pal. You never expect happiness and contentment among Formula One drivers or for the art of passing to be something that is ever simplified. But there is a bit of a handshake and a mutual agreement that, okay, we've reached that point where I need to relent for our mutual benefit. Just part of me partially concerned that Kevin may have broken that social contract with a few too many drivers last year, so that if and when he is in a position where he's, you know, able to go by or wanting to go by, folks might try and make things harder for him than they might someone else who they know they can fight with respectfully and, you know, possibly win the next engagement. So I don't know if there's anything there, but I know that Kevin's over-aggressiveness in situations where I didn't think they were warranted might be something where short memories would benefit him, but I don't know if folks are going to forget that, ooh, yeah, this guy doesn't just try and win. He tries to play really not nice while doing it. So I don't know if you think there's anything there, but it is a concern for me for his progression with Haas.
Yeah, I mean, he did cross the line a few times last year, but to be fair to him, quite often he could turn around and go, X driver is complaining, but there was no penalty, there was no investigation. You know, it was pushing it right to the limit and no further. And realistically, that's what you want your driver to do. That's what every driver should be doing, is making sure they don't cross the line, but they get as close to it as possible. And I think, yeah, to be honest, I think that there's a couple of drivers, Nico Hülkenberg springs to mind, that would eye Kevin up and be like, right, yeah, you're not coming past at all. But I think for most, they just know they're in for a hard fight. And I did an interview with Danny Ricciardo last year about the art of overtaking, and he says there's some he knows that they'll take him right to the white line, and that he's going to really have to work for it. And he said there's other drivers he knows that if you get your nose down inside, or you just get enough, that they'll put up a bit of a fight, but they won't go the whole way. And I just think people see Kevin, and they know that's coming. And they also know that when they make a move on him, they have to be really decisive. That's not a bad position to be in. If you've made that reputation for yourself, so people are aware it's you, and that, you know, that, and they're ready. They know they've got a fight on their hands. I think that's quite a good thing, because, you know, you're in their mind. You've already got sort of a jab in there. Whereas there's some drivers that, it's too difficult then to, if you start off with a kind of weaker